So, how does React state actually work? In other words, how does React handle updates? The first important thing to understand about React updates is how React communicates with the renderer, because it is the renderer that handles the update. I have already covered this in previous videos, but just to quickly recap, setState calls are forwarded to the renderer, in our case React DOM, using a field called updater. React DOM always sets this field before an update happens whenever an instance of a component is created. In terms of React hooks, the field is instead called dispatcher, but the principle is the same. Now to the update itself. When we call setState and pass in the new state or the update function, React takes that data and adds it to a queue. Eventually, the renderer decides to handle the updates and goes through them one by one. However, the changes are all applied at the end, at the same time. The changes are flushed to the DOM at once. React updates have a lot to do with React Fiber. I spoke about that in my video about React Fiber, and the key takeaway is that all of the updates are processed in two phases. During the first phase, the render phase, React calculates the new state and creates a list of effects that will be handled during the second phase. What is an effect? Effect is an activity like mutating the DOM, but it can also be a lifecycle method call. The first phase doesn't result into anything visible to the user, and because of that, it can be asynchronous. Then, after the first phase finishes, effects are applied. This process is called the second phase, also known as the commit phase, and because it results in changes visible to the user, this phase is always synchronous. I said that effects are activities like mutating the DOM or calling particular lifecycle methods. However, most lifecycle methods are actually called in the first phase. We will get to this later. The two phases and the list of effects is a good conceptual overview of what's going on, but in order to truly understand how React handles the updates, let's take a look at a practical example. I have created a simple application with a button, and when we click that button, the text changes. This is handled using state, and aside from the state change, there are several lifecycle methods that are all related to updates. Let's take a look inside. As you can see, I have defined a console.log in all of the lifecycle methods to see exactly when they are called. Now, if we take a look into the console, we can see getDerivedStateFromProps, shouldComponentUpdate, render and componentDidUpdate. The first interesting thing to notice is that some of the methods are called before render and one method is called after render. This has a lot to do with the two phases I previously spoke about. The first phase, the render phase, naturally ends with the render method, so the methods getDerivedStateFromProps and shouldComponentUpdate are part of the first phase. After that, the commit phase happens, and during that phase, the method componentDidUpdate is being called. Now, let's go through the methods one by one. The first one is getDerivedStateFromProps, and it is actually by far the hardest one to understand. The underlying idea is that it allows you to change state based on prop changes. If you take a look at my code, you can see that I am returning the state. Usually, you wouldn't just directly return the state, but you would adjust it based on the props, because that's what this function exists for. It takes props and state as parameters and should return the correct and possibly adjusted state. Derived means modified, so the method name makes sense, but you might wonder why is it actually called? In this component, we are just changing state, we aren't changing props. So why is the method getDerivedStateFromProps being called? If we take a look at the parameters again, we can see props and state, the state used for calculations. The method depends on props, so it is called after a prop change, but it also depends on state, so it only makes sense that it is called after a state change as well. If this method was called getDerivedStateFromProps and state, this would be much easier to understand. There is one more strange thing about this method, and that is the static keyword. This is quite interesting because it is the single static React lifecycle method. Static means that you can't access anything outside the method, like this.props, this.state, window, other methods, and so on. If you take a look at the other lifecycle methods, you can see next props, next state, previous props, previous state, but in getDerivedStateFromProps, we just have props. The result of this is that it prevents side effects from happening. Now, let's move on to the next method, which is shouldComponentUpdate. By default, a React component re-renders on every state change, but sometimes it is not necessary. shouldComponentUpdate is called directly before the render method and allows you to prevent re-rendering. It takes the newly computed props and state as parameters and allows you to compare them with the old props and state, which you can access using the this keyword, unlike the static getDerivedStateFromProps. This lifecycle method exists solely as a performance optimization. If shouldComponentUpdate returns true, render is called, and after that, the method componentDidUpdate is called. We will get to this later. Now is a good time to return to the two phases we previously spoke about. We know that getDerivedStateFromProps and shouldComponentUpdate are called during the first phase. Therefore, we can't have any side effects in them, and if we take a look at them again, it makes sense. getDerivedStateFromProps is static, so it's out of the question right away, and shouldComponentUpdate is also out of the question. Because why in the world would you have any side effects in a function like this? So that's the render phase. Now comes the commit phase with the method componentDidUpdate and all of the side effects. Because side effects are allowed during the commit phase, componentDidUpdate is the perfect place for them. componentDidUpdate runs after everything else has finished and allows us to make DOM changes, subscriptions, network requests, and even state changes. But the state change would have to be wrapped in a condition, otherwise it would result into an infinite loop. And those are all of the relevant methods. In the past, there existed the component will receive props and component will update methods, but those are now outdated and unsafe to use. Now, let's quickly go over the full update from a higher level. When we call setState, the new data is added to a queue. React then decides to handle the update, and it does so in two phases. During the first phase, React calculates the new state, calls getDerivedStateFromProps with this new state, and gets the possibly adjusted result. Afterwards, it calls shouldComponentUpdate with the final state, and if it returns true, the render method is called, and the first phase is finished. At the end of the first phase, React also creates an effect for the method componentDidUpdate, so it knows that it has to call it during the next phase. When the commit phase begins, React first makes the necessary DOM changes, so in our case, it changes the text of the button to I have been updated, and after that, it finally calls the method componentDidUpdate. And that's the full update, and that's also all for this video. If you have any questions, feel free to ask in the comments. In the next videos, I will temporarily focus on other technologies than React, but lately I have been thinking about doing a series on React concurrent mode, including suspense and so on. Let me know in the comments if this is something you would like to see. As always, if you enjoyed the video, be sure to leave a like and subscribe to see more videos like this in the future. Thank you for watching.